Okay, so today is 18th of May, and I'm privileged to host this meeting, a webinar on pandemic COVID-19. We are all suffering. Let me introduce myself. I'm Professor Dr. Vivek Gupta, Senior Consultant Cardiologist in Apollo Hospital and Chairman of Indo-European Conclave. And I'm sitting in Apollo Hospital. We are treating day in and out. I've just removed my mask and also face shield, and it is not an easy thing these days. The COVID-19 has been there for last almost 6 months, and let me introduce the panel first. I'm honored to have Madam Reeta Bahuguna Joshi in the panel as a social and a very important BJP leader and our close family friends. Welcome, Madam Reeta Bahuguna Joshi. Everybody can see you and hear you. Okay, and then we have in the panel Mr. Kamir, who is basically this is Pankaj Jeswani, our friend, who will be doing some sort of a live music at the end of the program. Then this is Mr. Moti Lal Sethi. He is an industrialist, and he is also the president of the garments export and trainee and exporter of Finnish leather, doing a lot of business in garments. He is a president of India Leather Garment Association and director for Leather Sector Skill Council and Panel Convener and Council for Leather Exports and Minister of Commerce, Government of India. Then I have to introduce Mr. Chakresh Jain. He is from basically Agra and Delhi, and he is a director and chairman in the PNC group. Mr. Zarir Cama, he is actually one of the very important economists from London, and he is basically has been a group manager and senior advisors in the HSBC London. He's now retired, but he's now a financial consultant and doing a good job, and he will be talking. Dr. Sharad Kohli has been a very important friend and partner. He's a director of many companies. I think it's a ACC company and also economist, and he's a doctorate in PhD in economy, and he has been actually doing a lot of work and coming on television on various panels. Then I will further introduce other people as they join. And then I'm introducing Mr. Sakate, Khaitan. His video is not there, but he's joined there. But he's a very important person. He's a legal partner. Good morning. Good afternoon. You're London. It's around lunchtime. I'm sorry to bother you during lunchtime. Sakate, Khaitan is actually a partner in the legal Khaitan's partner, and also advocate and also economist. And he's an advisor in the funds and corporate affairs of his firm. And I have already introduced all of them mostly, and other people who may be joining. Mr. Nirmal Jain is from Jaipur. He's All India Welfare Society, and he's doing big work for Jains, and he's involving a lot of Jain people and doing a lot of NGO work, especially for this COVID-19. So good afternoon, London, and good evening, everybody. And I start my presentation, which will be our 15 minutes. Then I will be as per the goes, then we'll take Mr. Zarir Cama, and then Madam Reeta Bahuguna Joshi ji. She has requested me to put a little short for her as she has another meetings. So I'll share my screen now. Let me just share the screen. So this is my presentation. So as a doctor, I would like to present first of all the COVID-19, which is a pandemic, and we all are suffering. And so this is my first slide. Everybody can see the slides?
Yeah.
Okay. So COVID-19, as the name goes, it is coronavirus disease 19. It started in Wuhan in December 19. That is why it is 19. Otherwise, we would have stored 20. It is one of the strains of coronavirus disease. SARS and MERS have already disturbed our whole community earlier in 2008 and 2002. And this program is organized by Indo-European Course on Revascularization. And we started this doing in global perspective. That was day before yesterday, was 46 lakhs. I could not update the slide. 46 lakh people overall were affected. It's one of the most important pandemic since the Spanish flu, which came in early 19th century, 1908. I was told, and there, as of today, there are more than 3,20,000 deaths. Indian perspective is touching now 1 lakh, which is more than China. So we are all talking to China. We were blaming, and China, as per their figure, although that figure may not be reliable, they have about only 83,000. India is about 90,000 with more than around 3,000 deaths. So despite the lockdown, and we are all worried about the lockdown, we are all at the same time as a doctor, I'm more worried about the patient suffering. More than 2,000, 4,000 patients around are getting infected every day, which is a real concern. Despite lockdown 4 hour, our honorable prime minister has extended the lockdown, but a lot of states are opening up and easing up the lockdown, which is a debatable thing. America is the worst sufferer. Mr. Donald Trump came to India in February 24. At that time, he had a huge delegation along with him, and I was on television. 24 February was my birthday also. I remember the date exactly. On that day, he visited Agra, Taj Mahal, and the Uttar Pradesh government, where Madam Reeta Bahuguna Joshi has been there, had a real big program for the Taj Mahal. At that time, nobody thought that this is going to be such a big problem. America, about 12 lakh people infected, and about 1 lakh, so 88,000 deaths. Or that was day before yesterday, must be around 90,000 deaths. There's a huge economic burden. We have been doing a lot of webinars. Madam, I would like to tell you, since April 15th, we have done more than, this is the sixth webinar in row. And I've also spoken for Sharda University and also spoken for the MIT University. So I have been reading a lot, although I'm a cardiologist, but I'm teaching. But I feel that the economic burden is huge, and that's why this program is the second to tell about the economic burden and business easing out or not. So Mr. Sharad Sakate Khaitan, Mr. Cama, Zarir Cama from London, and Mr. They will be telling us, Sharad Kohli will be telling more about it. Let me show myself. We are doing angiography and angioplasty as of now. Yesterday, Sunday evening, we did a very important cath on a patient who had a heart attack. So patients of heart attacks are a little suffering, because sometimes the patient hospital, as a policy, do not take the hospital unless we have a COVID-19 test done, and only those patients are hospitalized, or we keep them in isolation ward, a different category of ward, where we will do the testing of COVID-19. And when they turn out to be negative, then only we can do an angiography or angioplasty. This is a face shield we are using. I am not showing today's face. Today also I was using the face shield, and this was the angioplasty which we did, a tight lesion here, and now with the stent it's okay. So overall the things are a little difficult. This is all the hospital suffering. We have a lot of healthcare workers who are suffering. And many doctors, senior doctors too, at least I know in Apollo, who have got infected and they are hospitalized. So we are all in this, living in scare. And this is actually a virus disease, a little discussion, because I'm a doctor. So I have to tell you, a lot of this is going on Facebook Live on two places. My Facebook Live and Indians in Paris Facebook Live, which has more than 25,000 people. And there are a lot of Facebook Live. All the speakers have put on the Facebook Live. So I feel that more than 10,000-15,000 people are watching this, and this will be recurring again and again on the Facebook. So this is what is a virus disease, is that SARS virus enters into the cells, then there's the antigen presentation, and then there's cellular immunity and humoral immunity. So plasma treatment is dependent upon this area, while vaccine is dependent upon antigen. This is just to give an introduction to the people who are doctors, and there are people who are non-doctors. Coronavirus S protein has been reported as significant determinant of virus entry into the host cells. This virus is like generally any other virus. We all know whenever we talk of viral disease, we were taking it very lightly. We always say, oh, virus ho gaya, khansi, zukam, bukhar, theek ho jayega apne aap. Because at that time, we have immunity in the body. Unfortunately, this virus does not produce that much immunity, number one. And secondly, it has a huge problem that 20% patients will become so serious that they will require hospitalization because of pneumonia. So this virus is different, and not going to major details. This is the antigen presentation coronavirus infection, and then that leads to humoral and cellular immunity, and this leads to B and T cells. Two types of antibodies are produced, IgM and IgG, and they present earlier for the end of IgM antibodies, they disappear at the week 12, while IgG then takes over, and we are dependent upon the plasma treatment, as we all know, is dependent upon the antibodies, while vaccine is dependent upon the antigen. So this is different thing. The cytokine storm, I would like to tell you that out of 80 people who are out of 100, 80 will become normal within few days time. That means they will remain non-serious, while 20 will become serious to require hospitalization to the extent of ICU. Out of those 20, 10 will die. This is a huge, I'm talking from general perspective. If the patient is cardiac patient, he will die. The chances of death are more. Patient is diabetic, elderly, more than 80%. I'll show the slide later on. But cytokine storm is a condition where patient goes into acute respiratory distress syndrome and multi-organ failure, and finally lead to death. So this is a situation how the virus works. The diagnosis of COVID-19 is basically on the symptoms of cough, fever, and dyspnea. But we all know that we also do a testing, which is known as RT-PCR test. It is the antigen test. It is taken from the respiratory secretions. It is not a blood test. It is taken from the respiratory secretion, a throat swab. It takes about 10, 15, 12 or sometimes 48, 12, 24 hours for the report to come. This is the most important test we are dependent upon when there is an antibody test. But antibody test is not that important because that is different. I'll let you know later. But many times it has seen that patients of coronavirus disease, this is very important, a lot of people don't know. They may have a negative PCR test. They may have a negative PCR test. And then despite having a classical symptom, and these are the patients where CT scan is important to do. And CT scan shows a ground glass appearance. And that is why we are doing the CT scan in all the patients who are suspected, despite a negative CT, if they are suspected. If they are not suspected, then of course we will avoid this test. Antibody test is another test which is you must have realized and a lot of people are reading in the newspaper because media is teaching every day. There was an antibody test which was came from China, and that was actually later on ridiculed and returned back to China because it has very faulty testing. But NIV Pune, National Institute of Pune, they has developed India's first COVID-19 antibody testing test. And this is actually a blood test. And this is faster. It gives report within 15-20 minutes. This will tell you that you have suffered from, you have been exposed to antigen and now you are suffering. So this is something which is different. Niti Aayog is planning to do a 1.25 lakhs RT-PCR test per day. Let me tell you that testing is very important and the key of testing is the key to success. This is my first slide I was telling. As of today, India is doing about 1500 people per million test in general. 1500 people per million. America is doing 25 or 20,000 person per million. Germany was the maximum 5,000. France about 10,000. So we are lagging in testing, especially with the PCR test. Unless we have an antibody test, we will still be lagging. And that is why our graph is going up because we are testing more now. Earlier, we were not testing. We are 137 crore population and we are not able to test everybody. This is a dangerous virus and we have to be very careful. And I'm really worried with the lockdown opening up. Lockdown 4.0 is there. But so how medicines work? Medicine, there is still not a Rambal. Abhi tak koi aise ilaj abhi tak aaya nahi hai. Not even a single medicine which can be useful and we can say ki this is a Rambal. Ab aap theek ho jaoge. But medicines are hydroxychloroquine medicine and remdesivir, they are two medicines. When the virus enters the cell, it leads to formation of protein, mRNA, RNA, this is for the medical people. And various medicines, they work at different level to counter the virus. Remdesivir, which is an antivirus medicine, has been FDA approved recently. They work at the RNA level. Coming on to the hydroxychloroquine, a lot has been discussed. I would like to take away a very important, I will give another 2-3 minutes about hydroxychloroquine. Because hydroxychloroquine has been cleared by Indian Council of Medical Research for prevention for the healthcare workers. And as a healthcare worker myself, doctor, nurses, ward boys, housekeeping boys, pharmacy boys, delivery boys inside the hospital, they all should take it. It is not that much cardiotoxic. A lot of the research have shown it is cardiotoxic. It is a medicine not for malaria. It is the brother of chloroquine. It is used for rheumatoid arthritis patients very often and very well known medicine. Prophylaxis as a healthcare worker is important, but I would increase my level of this to also the field workers who like policemen, like people who are working on the field. They should also take it. 400 milligram only one day, twice daily, only one day, and then 400 milligram once a week. For 7 weeks is the Indian Council of Medical Research guideline, which came in March. When I'm talking to people in Apollo Hospital, a lot of patients have taken and a lot of patients have still not taken. So there are lot of confusion, but I would like to clear that this is otherwise a safe drug. If your ECG is normal and if your cardiologist is allowing it, it is safe drug, you should take it. Coming on to the utility of hydroxychloroquine in the treatment. What I was talking earlier was in the prevention. Now I'm talking about the treatment. So the treatment is concerned, the French professor, virologist, very important in February 2020, he had downloaded a video after China said it is useful. I don't know whether you are hearing this voice, it's a French. So what he's saying in February, that this hydroxychloroquine should not be used. This is February, but in March, April 9, 1 month back, he did a patient's study on 1,000 patients. And the study showed that this is a very good clinical outcome, 91% success and only 0.4% death in the patients suffering from COVID. Now we are talking of the treatment. As I told you that a lot of patients are lost, and we have lost many patients in Apollo Hospital, which has 81 bed reserved in Apollo Hospital for COVID-19. That means this is a study from the French doctor who said earlier he was laughing on it when the China said okay. Then he himself did a study on 1,000 patients of COVID-19 and this found to be useful. So this is an eye-opener for many of the people. Chinese had said earlier in February that this can be useful alternative when there is no specific medicine against this virus. FDA, US FDA gave an emergency utilization that was 28th March, and later on they changed the guidelines April 25. And if you remember, there was a huge rush. And there was a, in fact, Mr. Donald Trump, president of USA, had requested to stop ban which was done for the export of hydroxychloroquine by our government of India. So he requested our honorable prime minister that this hydroxychloroquine be allowed to be exported from India to US, because India is the maximum number one producer of this medicine. So I have still open mind. I feel that we are giving this medicine to all the patients, for the healthcare workers and those who are in the field. They should also take as prophylaxis if their ECG is normal. So this is important guideline, I would say, those who are in the field. Even I would say the people who are in the field means they are the people who are in the politics. They are meeting a lot of people. Of course, there is a mask there. This is a good prophylaxis one should always take. And I have already told the dose is very simple. Dose is only 400 milligram, one daily, once only one day, two times. And then 400 milligram, once a week for 7 weeks. That's all. Coming on to the medicines, there are a lot of medicines being tested, and repurposed medicines means the medicine which is being used for some other purpose, can they we try them for this COVID-19 till we have a specific Rambar, we don't have it. So my father, I would like to highlight this thing. My father, Dr. Emil Gupta, has been done a lot of research with Indian Council of Medical Research. He was assistant director, retired now. He has proposed to PMO an important drug which is otherwise a medicine which is being used for some other purpose, and this is under trial, will start soon. And he has proposed, he's been a big researcher, he has more than 100 to 20 to 30 publications which are being cited today. So I would, because I feel proud in telling that my father has proposed at this age of 80 to that some medicine which is he feels should be useful, and he has done research in Indian Council of Medical Research while doing it, and this is pending in Indian Council of Medical Research, and the trial will start soon. One medicine which has shown very important promise is ivermectin. This is actually anti-parasite medicine which is approved by FDA. This is again another antivirus. It is not antivirus medicine. It is anti-parasite agent approved by FDA for anti-parasite. This has been tested in vitro. In vitro means in the laboratory. And this has shown that COVID-19 virus is finished within 48 hours completely. And this is the only medicine which has shown promise in vitro, in the lab. The human trials have to start very soon. If this is useful, then this medicine can be a game changer, not hydroxychloroquine. Hydroxychloroquine for prevention is as good. For treatment, there is doubt. A lot of American study have come recently that this may not be useful, but there is no harm in giving. It is a rather safe drug. But this ivermectin should have a human trial. One word about remdesivir. Everybody is reading in the newspaper antiviral medicine and remdesivir. Remdesivir is an antiviral medicine used for many other virus. Especially it was used in Ebola treatment, but it failed in Ebola treatment. But based on the data, the FDA has issued an emergency use authorization. It is now FDA approved. Unfortunately, it is very difficult to get in India. Still, it is not available because there is a patent and we were getting it. Shortly, we will get it. I think few. Not easy to get India. There is no Indian medicine company which can make it because there is a patent with the American company. So this is the one. Coming on to the mask, I am touching at one every point. Mask is very important. If you remember when Mr. Donald Trump came in February, nobody was using the mask, although the virus was there in the whole world. At that time, nobody took it so seriously. And this is 3-ply mask, and this is the N95. N95 always for all the healthcare workers. I want to give you a small reminder. This is March 26. I was on TV9 Bharatvarsh. At that time, I raised a point. So I what I was telling on this, and this is March 29. So what I was telling in this video was 29th March, and there was no guideline as such, and people was laughing at me and they were criticizing me. Why you are creating panic? Why should everybody wear the mask on the road? Why should everybody should put a rumal? And I used the word angocha. And I'm very happy that in the first week of April, even our honorable Prime Minister Narendra Modi ji said, depending upon the guideline, that everybody, poor people cannot have mask, they should at least wear gamcha or angocha. And I was the first person that way on 29th March to raise the point on television. And that time people did not believe me. But I was very, very happy that this is very important thing which we have to do, because the virus can be airborne. It can be airborne, WHO said, and that time I was speaking on Republic Bharat, I said it can be airborne. I was thinking a possibility because I was taking it more seriously. What is vaccine? Vaccine is the only thing which can actually prevent the virus coming inside the body. Still, the vaccine is still long term. Lot of things you are coming, you are seeing every day in the whole newspaper. Italy has made it, Israel has made it, vaccine will come within a few days. Let me tell you, the WHO, and we have done a lot of webinar with Italians, with Americans, vaccine is at least it is 6 months to 1 year away. So this is a bad news actually. So what is vaccine? Vaccine is made when the antigen type of virus is something, what's the same protein which virus is made to go inside the body, and then especially the antibodies are produced, and which will help the patient of anybody who is exposed to the coronavirus not to get infected. So it could be 1 year away. More than 70 vaccines in the whole world are being tested, and they are, everybody is saying that this is, as of 16th of May, even as country toy the idea of relaxing down and restarting life in the COVID area, the novel coronavirus continue to claim more lives. As of now, more than this is, there are only 7 or 8 top candidates of COVID-19. This is WHO on 16th May, they said. And what are those? Moderna vaccine, America-based. Then we have Novavax vaccine, also America-based. Receive funding of $388 million. This is Novavax. Then you have a Ivivo vaccine. Then US drug maker Pfizer is trying to do it. Johnson & Johnson is trying to come up with the vaccine. This is Chinese vaccine, CanSino Biologics. They all are under trial. As of now, no human trial has come out completely. Then AstraZeneca was, Oxford, University of Oxford is the first to start the human trial. And they say that they may come up with the vaccine expected in May 2021, next year. That means we have to have some medicine which should work. So this is Oxford trial, which was coming, a lot of things with them, Sanofi, French. What about India? India by BBL Bharat, India BCG vaccine, which is produced, they are also testing whether this can boost the immunity to the extent, and the vaccine, this has started. So other vaccines in pipeline, Italian have said that they have started a human trial. But Israel has said is important. I will finish my talk within 5-10 minutes. That what Israel has produced is monoclonal antibody, which is used for the treatment. So this is something which is unprecedented. They have seen the sound, have to mute everybody. I don't know how to do it. Okay, let me continue. So monoclonal antibody is the only thing which can be very useful. Israel has made it. If this is useful, then this will be very useful, because this will be treatment. This is antibody produced outside, and when you inject this into the patient, patient death will be reduced and patient will recover. What about if the vaccine does not come at all? This is a really scary situation. You remember that HIV vaccine is still not come, dengue vaccine is still not come. Lot of vaccine are being still in the pipeline to test it. If the vaccine does not come, do we have to live with coronavirus? This is dangerous. HIV, of course, we all know it is sexually transmitted disease, or it is transmitted only from the blood to blood. You can save yourself. But here it is a human to human transmission. It can be airborne. It can be on the particulate matter. We have to be very, very careful. Even Boris Johnson, who has recovered, he said, Johnson has warned that in the worst case scenario, a vaccine may never be found. Why we are thinking like this? Because For example, HIV, for example, dengue. And there are also many other diseases where, despite the WHO putting a lot of money, Mr. Bill Gates putting a lot of money, the vaccine has not come. So we have to be very, very careful. Contact tracing. This is an Arogya Setu app, which everybody should download. This is one step beyond the social distancing. How this will help? This helps now. If you have this app on your mobile Android phone, then if you get coming in contact with any infected patient, then this app will tell you that, okay, red signal will come. You are in contact with a person who was COVID-19 positive, and therefore quarantine yourself, do your testing. So this is one way of preventing a spread. There are a lot of American, European trials, recovery trials for various antivirus disease coming up. Plasma treatment is only reserved for a very sick patient who requires ventilator. This is important for people to know that this is not for everybody. Only as of now, it is on the research side. Lot of patients still have died despite plasma therapy. What is plasma therapy? A COVID-19 patient recovered, who has recovered. We take out the blood, we take out antibody, infuse the patient who is sick, who is on ventilator, and patient may actually recover. Herd immunity. This is what Stockholm did. Sweden did not plan a major lockdown. What they did, the whole Europe was locked down. They thought that herd immunity will come. What is herd immunity? This is a simple diagram to understand that when the virus is spreading in the community, everybody gets infected, few will die, few will produce immunity, and few will become safe. This is herd immunity. But this is normally for all the virus, generally, but this is not good for this particular COVID-19 because it is killing 10% people. If you allow everybody to be infected, then you lose a lot of life. So this is something which is the herd immunity and lockdown. India has relaxed down for discharge of COVID-19 patients. Parks are being opened in the government has decided to resume train services before. So this is something what is there. I am telling you that despite the lockdown being eased out, we have to really worry. Most COVID-19, the disease caused by novel coronavirus, either asymptomatic. What about asymptomatic carrier? I was talking to my colleague just now a few hours back. One person is infected, he's asymptomatic. He infects another person, he remains and he becomes symptomatic. This person who is infected, young man, who has good immunity, he does not even have my major symptom. One day fever, one day of cough, he says, okay, chhota khaansi zukaam bukhar tha, and next day he recovers. He remains asymptomatic, he's infected, asymptomatic, 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 and then they become negative. So a lot of people are actually asymptomatic and they will keep infecting others despite not showing major infection symptom in them. So this is a scary situation, and I tell you, in Apollo Hospital, two senior consultants are hospitalized and two junior doctors are there. Many nurses are hospitalized. We have lost a lot of things. Japan came closer to successful example of this counter COVID-19 strategy. With a comparable population density with India, Japan too enforced lockdown provinces and only 16,000 patients were infected. This was May 11. Herd immunity in lockdown, the lockdown is important. We have to continue. Without lockdown, India would have been in a worse situation. A study of International Institute of Population Sciences say, a deemed university, that if we had not put a lockdown, more than 30 lakh patients would have been suffering in India. So the importance of lockdown is because one patient can infect 400 people. 400 people. This is according to ICMR. So this is that this virus is dangerous in two ways. First of all, it can kill. There is no medicine as of now. Secondly, it is highly contagious. That means if you are just standing in front of somebody and who is having virus, and you will not know and they will infect you. It is highly infective virus. This is a very difficult situation. Anybody speaking, speech can lead to virus. It can remain on the particular matter. I am telling you example of today. Yesterday evening there was panic in Apollo. Why? Because there is a person who serves coffee and tea in the consultant lounge in Apollo Hospital. The person who is serving tea and coffee in consultant lounge in Apollo Hospital, he got infected. Now a lot of people, including myself, they go and take the tea and coffee there. Okay, chai de do, bahadur chai de do. Chai de do, coffee de do. Bread supply de do. Now when he got infected, now everybody who say, unfortunately, I did not visit that place. During last 15 days, I was sending my secretary to bring the coffee for me. So I have asked my secretary to please don't come for the next 14 days. So the situation is not that, I'm not scaring you. Our Prime Minister said 2P. 1P precaution, 2P panic. Don't panic, but take precaution. So herd immunity is not coming. How India is preparing? India has set aside about 1.35 lakhs hospital bed ICU plus oxygen support. Reports suggest that less than 1.5% are currently occupied. That means ICUs are reserved. So India is learning from Wuhan and India is learning from Italy. I remember I telling you that in Italy what happened, that one ventilator, three patients. So as such, India is preparing better. We are learning from West under the leadership of Honorable Prime Minister, Mr. Modi ji, Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, all the chief minister of various states. We are preparing ourselves better. And that is why not many deaths. You can hide infection, but you cannot hide the death. So as of now, deaths are not that many. So protocol is there, 7 days. Discharge patient under modified norms are required to follow a 7-day home quarantine or isolation. Earlier patient were to be isolation for 14 days. They're reducing the norms. But this opens up the risk that some of the COVID-19 patients discharged from hospital may spread the virus to a new person. So I would say that although the norms are being eased, but we have to be very careful. So ventilator treatment, let me tell you one example. Many people curse private hospitals. Are unko ventilator laga diya paisa banane ke liye. We used to feel hurt. Now we understand that ventilator is actually a life-saving thing when your oxygenation is disturbed to the extent that your saturation goes down below 90. This is life-saving till your lungs come back to normal. And I told you that Italy, it happened. I have a lot of friends in Italy, doctors. They said the whole hospital was converted to COVID hospital. So in Italy, what happened? Every ventilator are exhausted. Only one is left. Now three patients requiring it. They were choosing. Okay, this man is 80-year-old. He will die soon. We will not give ventilator to him. This person is 40. Let us give ventilator to him. That happened in China and Wuhan. And it's also in America. Now they have increased. Healthcare workers are the worst affected. And they have to be, I told you, we are using the face shield, we are using PPE kit. And still, I would say this was a big thing when people clapped at 5 p.m. when Honorable Prime Minister said this. In fact, whenever I meet a person, I'm not going to COVID ward, I'm a cardiologist. But the other people are going to COVID ward, I still salute them that they have that much of level of courage, or I would say the bravery. Coming on to the plasma role of China, I would like to read out one professor, Hanjo from Japan. He said, he is a Nobel laureate. He gave a sort of news that this is 100% Wuhan, China made. Honorable Indresh ji was there with us in last webinar. This, he said, it is human made. In fact, America, Mr. Donald Trump is every day is on loudly saying that it is human made. So we are not sure. So this is something I'm not going to discuss. Human and heart, this is the last slide. The patient's mortality is 4-5% in general. More than 80 years, 15% patient will die. With heart patient, 10%. With diabetes, 7%. This is February 24 guideline. This is China. But later on, guidelines are different. So there is last thing which I want to tell you. There are patients who are delivering and they are COVID positive. The children born will not be COVID positive. This research has shown. So one should not worry about that issue. Now I think I'll have to finish my presentation. I have to stop sharing the slide. And then I will request other people to come and join in. And this is about 6:15. I'm asking Madam Reeta Bahuguna ji, if she is comfortable, can we take an international speaker before you? And Mr. Sharad Kohli, can we take?
Sure.
Okay. So what I will request, according to sequence, I will request now Mr. Zarir Cama to come in and speak from London. Then I will take Mr. Sharad Kohli from India. And then we will take Madam and then other people, because she has to leave. But this is a very interesting webinar. Although I spoke basically on heart, but basically I want other people to tell about the economy, because as of today, when Mr. Donald Trump says, there was a very important discussion with one of the journalists. He asked Mr. Donald Trump, you are easing out, what about the death? So Mr. Donald Trump said, when you have no money, how will you survive? So this is something different, but this is not a good answer, I would say. He said, if you have no money, how will you survive? So this is now Mr. Zarir Cama, who has been with HSBC and lot of finance background, will come and join us. I've unmuted him. Welcome, Mr. Zarir Cama, known as Zed in general. Hello, Zed, how are you?
I'm fine, thank you. Can you hear me?
Yeah, you're clear and loud. Please go ahead.
Excellent, good. Well, thank you very much for this opportunity. Now, I'm not an economist, okay? I'm just an ex-banker. So please, we should get that straight. So you're not going to get millions of figures from me. But I'm just going to, you know, I wrote this paper up and I'll go through that quickly with yourselves. So it's to do with COVID and the world economy, right? So I'm going to give a very general sort of talk. Now, to believe that the world economy is changing just because of COVID-19 would be naive and put the experiences of the more recent past into some form of memory loss. This is not the first and will not be the last time that serious change will happen. If we look back over the last 100 years or so, the two biggest events that took place to displace the then world order, first was the Great Depression of 1929 with its economic consequences, which turned into the political chaos of the 1930s and led to the second great disruptor, which was World War II. Now, coming out of that chaos, we move to the stage of a bipolar world, the US and Soviet Russia. Both built their economic models out of that disruption. The US with Bretton Woods and the World Bank, IMF, etc., and the Soviet Union with their model of state control. India, because of its recent struggle for independence and seeing the West as inherently colonial in its outlook and nature, and hence an oppressor, took on the Soviet model, which proved, in fact, very costly in the long run. Now, much has happened since, and 1991 was the watershed for India as it began casting off that mantle. Now, whilst the 2008 and 2009 financial crisis had a huge impact on the global economy and created financial fear, what COVID has done is in fact a double whammy. It has created personal and unprecedented fear. Real or imagined, one has to wait and see. Clearly, what Dr. Gupta was saying earlier is that in his view, it is certainly not imagined and it is very, very real. So it has created this very personal and unprecedented fear on an unimaginable scale, resulting in economic devastation and in a very drastically and dramatically short space of time, which has been seen, which has never been seen, right, outside of a world war. The sudden collapse of the pillars of the world economy have been devastating, with combined world GDP falling at rates never seen before. Personal fear of the unknown has been the driving force, which has resulted in the collapse of high employment industries, such as aviation, tourism, entertainment, clothing, etc. And building these back will take time, but the damage this will have caused will be difficult to recoup in the same numbers, and certainly not in the short term. As if this isn't bad enough, you have certain other factors, both political and economic, which are having and will have as big an impact. And that is to do with the structural side of the global economy. Protectionism is in the air, and the era of globalization may be over. The ground beneath our feet, as the author Salman Rushdie put it, is shifting, and old certainties do not hold anymore. Challenges lie essentially, I think, in three domains: economic, geopolitical, and institutional. In the economic realm, the global economy might go through a 1929-style depression, and countries' weaknesses will be highlighted. For instance, since 2016, Indian economy has largely been in the doldrums. And we hope, in fact, now that that begins changing with some of the new initiatives which are coming about. Geopolitically, and this is important, things are reaching ahead with China, a rising superpower, and the US, the ruling superpower, taking on each other. For India, this is going to be a problem, because the US will play off India against China, and China will play Pakistan against India. India is a democracy, and all democracies need wise leadership. and above all, strong institutions, which currently all these institutions everywhere need considerable help. What helped the world come back after World War II was the setting up of global institutions such as the IMF, World Bank, etc., and similar institutions within the countries. This served us very well. However, over the years, these have been severely eroded. Unfortunately, as an example, you have seen the US led today, frankly, in the most erratic way possible, leading to and deepening uncertainties. At the same time, as an unpredictable virus is affecting everybody. So this joining together of these two things has come at a very, very unfortunate time. The confluence of these two is making things even harder to predict and plan for. Globalization, as we have known it, is possibly over, with the rise of nationalism almost everywhere. Here in the UK, Brexit is a stark reminder and example. Coming at this time, it could and possibly will result in the worst economic decline seen over centuries. Predicting falls in GDP growth is a pointless exercise. It is unrealistic, as unrealistic, frankly, as Russian roulette is. Global supply chains will move closer to their own markets as they diversify from single source manufacture. This is still work in progress, but it will definitely happen. We are currently looking at a massive amount of economic disruption, collapse in consumer demand, unemployment rising, factories halted. So this is a time for a rethink globally. No matter what anyone says, China will remain a major supplier, but people will not put all their eggs in one basket. So countries are strategizing now. Trump has taken a sledgehammer to the export-led growth model. With COVID-19, unfashionable ideas are beginning to reemerge. Greater protectionism to help local industries tied to security concerns. So protectionism, in fact, has never really gone away. For India, I would say the challenges are economic, strategic, and institutional. This could be also, at the same time, a great opportunity to change positively. And I hope India grasps the nettle. Time will tell. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Mr. Cama, for your real insights. So whether you are an ex-banker or you have knowledge about finance, which we don't have. So thank you. It was a great talk about this. And if Madam allows me, then I will take Mr. Sharad Kohli, and then I will take a good wisdom from Madam Reeta Bahuguna Joshi. Mr. Sharad Kohli is a very good speaker, and he knows a lot of economy. Actually, he's an economist. We have to take him at this point of time. So may I request Mr. Sharad Kohli, please introduce yourself and speak and give your thought process about the Indian economy as such, which you are telling everybody on television. Sorry, you are not... Okay.
Okay. Thank you so much, Dr. Gupta. It's indeed a matter of pleasure to be among such august speakers all the way from London, from India. Madam Reeta Bahuguna, thank you so much, Madam, for being there. It's an absolute pleasure for all the learned speakers, who some of whom I can see all at one go because I'm using an iPad, so I'll have to flip to see some of the other speakers. Absolutely a pleasure. And when Dr. Gupta said that he was speaking about heart, I said even the discussion of economy is about heart, because when you lose money, when you lose livelihoods, when you lose business, I think heart is affected even then. So Dr. Gupta, everything finally comes down to heart, be it direct or be it indirect. So therefore, economy is not too far from cardiology, is what I wanted to say to start with. So. I think an unprecedented situation, never before. I'm sure nobody sitting here is 100 years old to have witnessed the 1929, which Zed had mentioned, the Great Depression. Nobody of us has seen that. Well, $90 trillion, some of you might be interested in some numbers. I mean, I'm full of numbers, but I don't want to bore you with a lot of numbers. $90 trillion is the world economy. Me, you, everyone else sitting on the panel, and the rest of the world, what we earn together is about, we call it that the GDP, is about $90 trillion. Now, it is estimated that $10 trillion after this pandemic would be wiped off. So we will only be left with about $80, $81 trillion. And mind you, the erosion itself is of the size of Japan and Germany. This is as big as it can get. So that is the kind of loss we are estimating. We are 7 billion people living on this earth. And it is expected that 1.6 billion will lose their jobs. So a very interesting thing I would like to share with you, that before we went into the lockdown, I'm not saying this about the doctors, but at least for everybody else, when we went into the, let's say, for Indian lockdown on 23rd of March or 24th of March, we probably thought that after the lockdown, like we go on a summer vacation, you go on a summer vacation, you come back from your vacation and you resume from where you had left. Your life resumes. Jahan choda tha, wahin se shuru kar dete hain. We resume from there. But unfortunately, or fortunately, or coincidentally, this time when you resume after lockdown, things will never be the same again. We will be stepping into a new world altogether, because the whole there's going to be a paradigm shift in the economy of every single country. Some of the biggest economies in the world, like the United States, United Kingdom, France, Germany, Italy, I think they have taken a hit which they had never ever imagined in the wildest of their dreams. United States has already lost about 36 million jobs. In UK, I mean, I'm sure Zed hasn't stepped out of the house, but some of the visuals that I saw, I've got a lot of friends in London. They said that in London, which is supposed to be one of the wealthiest place on earth, and in New York, another wealthy place on earth, we have seen just before the lockdown, when President Trump probably delayed the lockdown and all the controversy, we have seen people begging on the roads. We have seen people starving on the roads. They had no food, no place to live. In Indian terminology, we call it as bhukmari. That bhukmari was seen literally in countries who got trillions and trillions of dollars and pounds of reserves. So such has been the impact around the world, absolutely unprecedented. And I think what I'll do is I'll be brief, because I know there are a lot of speakers, and I would love to listen to immediately after me, Madam Bahuguna. To give you, share some numbers with you. We have in India, we've got a working population, including me and you, of about 50 crore people. 13 crore poor families are there in our country. And assuming that each family has about 5 to 6 people, I'm assuming 6 people because the poorer families are joined, they've got larger number of people in the family. On an average, if we assume 6 people for a family, we have about 80 crore poor people. When I say poor, I mean people who earn less than about 7,000 rupees a month. You know, I'm talking of poor people. So out of the 50 crore workforce, that is one data, 80 crore poor people out of 132 crore that we are, 80 crore are poor. Now, out of the 50 crore working population, about 40 crore, which is 80%, works for the unorganized sector, which is they don't have appointment letters. They are small time. They work with the MSMEs. They work as carpenters, electricians, cobblers, you know, here and there. They don't have appointment letters. Their livelihood is not secured, like the people who work in organized sector, who've got a provident fund and who've got proper appointment letter and so and so. Now, it is estimated that out of these 40 crore people, about 15 crore will lose their livelihood, are easily going to lose their livelihood. So that is the magnitude of the economic problem which government of India is right now facing. Now, I'll be more contemporary in my dialogue because fortunately the webinar is happening at a time when yesterday we just finished, 5 rounds of, in fact, there were 2 previous rounds also, total of 7 rounds of government coming forward, apart from RBI, coming forward to introduce the stimulus package. Now, the government has done, I would say, a wonderful job because it has tried to infuse liquidity into the system. It's been a package which has been a mix of more of holding hands in midterm and long term, although there's been a lot of political debate about something should have been put into the pockets of people. There was an immediate need to do something. There was an immediate need to put cash. Anyway, because this is not a political platform, so I would not get into that. I would appreciate the government for what it has done in terms of the 20 lakh crore. I would say a credit and liquidity targeted stimulus package. So what this package would do is, instead of putting money in the pocket of people, let's say 10,000 rupees each or 7,000 rupees each in the pockets of every single person, which would not have lasted probably for more than I would say a month or probably 2 months for very poor people. I think a better solution is, which government thought, is to make them stand on their own feet so that their future is secured in medium to long term. They make a better employee, they make a better factory, they make a better MSME. So that has been the focus. But then, having said that, I still feel, because Indian economy, if we see in particular, I will be a little more focused in my brief talk about Indian economy. About 60% of the Indian economy is constituted of service sector. About 25% of the Indian economy is constituted about manufacturing and allied services. And rest, of course, come 16 to 17% is agriculture, if there is a slight overlap between manufacturing and agriculture, if we do that. And unfortunately, for that 60% agricultural contribution in the GDP, 60 to 70% of the population directly or indirectly depends on that. So which makes them more vulnerable. But having said that, I would make a very interesting statement that Indian economy, for the people who are not interested in economics, I mean, this is a very useful thing. 60 to 65% of Indian economy is made up of consumers. That is, we are a consumer-driven economy. I mean, I would not like to go into the finer details of economics as to what constitutes a GDP, but assume that 65% of our economy is driven by demand, which is we go and buy things, and because we buy things, so the economy runs, and 65% of that part basically runs on. So there is a very strong possibility, and I firmly believe that Indian economy will spring back from this crisis the quickest amongst all. Only country which was supposed to be quicker than India was China. But then after what China has exported to the world, China was exporting $2.5 trillion every year to the world, which is closer to the size of the Indian economy, the Chinese exports. But export karte karte, look what China has exported. It has literally devastated the world. I mean, the world economy is on the knees. Millions of people affected, lakhs of people killed, notwithstanding the fact that China has not yet revealed the total quantum of deaths. When I know personally, because I had contacts in China, that about 10 million SIM cards in China, which were regular users 3 times a day, are not ringing anymore. One crore SIM cards in China. So therefore, the number of deaths are also not accurately predictable, because some of the countries are not sharing the actual data for the sake of rating, for the sake of their reputation, for the sake of investments coming in, for the sake of future tourism, and so on and so forth. Let us not go into that. So the IMF prediction said that China would be growing at 9% in the year 2021-22. And India would be growing at 7%. Whereas I partly agree with IMF that China will not grow at 9% because of the angst against China. There is angst in America, there is angst in Europe, there is an angst in Australia, there is angst in so many countries who are now deeply upset with the way China handled the crisis, whether it was man-made or whether it was deliberate, non-deliberate. Let's not go into that discussion. But the fact of the matter is that the world is upset with China. So when the world is upset with China, you can't expect Chinese economy to start booming, considering that it's one global village in terms of business. So I think India will become a huge beneficiary. And I think Prime Minister's call of the four pillars of L, land, labor, liquidity, and law, divided into four major divisions. I'm not going into details of Prime Minister's speech right now because that is a different discussion. But I think with the intent of the government being very noble, the government is in the seize of the opportunity that this is the right time now for India to take off and become world's factory, which China has been known for so long. I think so. In every crisis, there is an opportunity. So I would not like to drag this because I can speak for 24 hours and I'll probably end up consuming rest of your webinar, Dr. Gupta, in my speech of economics, because I can just go on and on. But I'll like to wrap it up sooner, and I would wait if somebody has got a question, maybe I can be focused on that. My take is that India in the year 2021-22, under the guidance of this government with all the good intent, has the capacity to become an economic superpower, because the opportunity which comes India's way, although there are more competitors, there is Vietnam, there is Cambodia, there is Mexico, there is Indonesia, there is Malaysia. It's not that all factories uprooting themselves from China are all going to come to India. They will probably try other alternates also. But the kind of demographic dividends which India gives, the kind of efficiency, English speaking, the kind of competence which India gives, I think it will be hard for other countries to match. So I think here is an opportunity for all of us as Indians, under the guidance of this government, where we can probably become a world economic superpower. So from the year, I would close down on a very optimistic note. From the year, this is a temporary disruption. This too shall pass, as they say. From the year 21-22, I can tell you, it's my own analysis as an economist, India will be on its way to become a superpower with the government intent correlating with that, which is already visible. So we are in for very good times. I think Corona would not just be one medically, but I think Corona will end up benefiting our country like anything else. There is a sher in Urdu, which is put up in a negative way. I have changed. It says, "Ibtidai ishq hai rota hai kya? Aage aage dekhiye hota hai kya?" So this is generally said because people who are in love, you know, it is said that they face problems. Abhi to shuruaat hai. I say ibtidae mahamari hai, rota hai kya? Ab isme se positive ye lena hai, aage aage dekhiye hota hai kya? I think India is the next world economic superpower. With those words, ladies and gentlemen, I like to wrap up. I love to listen to others, and thank you, Dr. Gupta, for having me here. I would love to have any questions with you later. And thank you very much.
Thank you, Sharad. You have spoken so well, and you are actually a economist. You have to win PMO, actually, in fact. Okay, so I would now request Madam Reeta Bahuguna Joshi. But at the same time, when she finishes her talk, I would request her to stay back. Then I would request Mr. Sakate Khaitan, who is also from London, to speak. So I would request you not only that you should go away, but you should speak, but you should stay back to listen to other people, because they will be happy to see you staying back. So may I request Honorable Reeta Bahuguna Joshi, who has been a big pillar for earlier Congress. I have no reason not to say that. And of course, she was so close to Sonia Gandhiji. I know the whole thing. And then her father has been a pillar figure, and her brother has been a chief minister. She herself has been a big orator. She joined BJP for the good, and now she became the minister in the Uttar Pradesh government with Yogi ji. And now she's a BJP member of parliament from Allahabad, a very true politician, working for her own heart, not like another, a very highly educated lady. And I have a lot of respect for her. So please welcome, I'm welcoming Madam Reeta Bahuguna Joshi, to have your social or otherwise, whatever message you want to give in relation to this pandemic, which you were all suffering.
Thank you, Professor Vivek Gupta, Dr. Gupta. I'm grateful to you making me part of this webinar. And we had two very enlightened just expositions briefly on the economy of the country. And you gave us a brilliant insight into certain aspects of Corona, which were still not well known to us. See, one of the expositions were international, the other was totally Indian. And I associate myself with most of the things that Dr. Kohli has said. And I myself have been optimistic all my life. And when Narendra Modi is the Prime Minister of your country, you have to be optimistic, because you know that he means business. From the very start, India has been talking about this, about being honoring the local and going global. As far as this pandemic is concerned, it has swept the world off its feet. And for a lot of time, even till now, people are absolutely confused how to restart their own lives. And I see not only an economic and geopolitical aspect, but the social aspect also is absolutely important, very important. because I see that families, you know, there's a lot of fear. There is a lot of suspicion. There is doubt about their own lives. And I see the hordes of people who are now returning home. They are in a very pitiable condition. They're in a very, very, you know, difficult situation. They could not have stayed where they are. And we all know that there are more than 8 crore migrant workers in India. And if we say that even half of them are returning, you can imagine every village is going to be flooded with the migrant workers. And they are now jobless, they are penniless, because during the pandemic, they have lost most of their money, despite the fact that the government of India has put 1,65,000 crores through DBT and other measures for the relief of these migrant workers and those poor who were locked out during the lockdown. So I feel there's a psychological impact, which is very dangerous. Like, you know, Indian families are joint families. How do you spend this community spread? We know that there is a single kitchen for more than 50 people in the villages in one family. And the smallest family would have about 20, 25 members. So this pandemic is actually very frightening as far as India is concerned. But the thing is that we cannot lock out for very long. We have to let the economy come back, restart. And as it was rightly said, if there's no money, how do you live? As Dr. Vivek Gupta said. So why we can realize and we know the dangers of this pandemic spread, community spread, we have to gradually open up. And this is what India is doing. We should congratulate Narendra Modi. He was one of the first prime ministers, world leader, who really started the lockdown at a very early time. Though you all are saying that Dr. Vivek Gupta said, we are testing less before we are less. But when we die, the deaths are recorded. And every death we know why it has happened. So we know that the coronavirus and the COVID-19 has not yet had that impact on us, which the other developing countries have faced. And right now, our levels are very, very low in terms of 1.3 billion people. And look at the figures that we are showing. Even if they're not very realistic, they are not very unrealistic as well. So what I feel is not the best, the most important thing right now is to restart the lives of those who are migrating back to their homes. How do we do that? So for this, the best way, I agree with the professor, Dr. Kohli, that you see India's biggest strength is in its MSMEs, micro, small, and small scale industries, cottage industries. Village industry. This is a basic strength. And we all know that India has more than 300 million, 3 crore MSMEs. UP alone has 90 lakh MSMEs. So if we can revive the economy here, because my chief minister, Yogi Adityanath, said that even if we restart or if we revive these MSMEs, if we give a fillip to them, if they allow them to, we allow them to grow, and if even one of them takes one person additional on their board, our problem is solved, basically, because one person in our country is not a family of 2 or 3, it's a family of 10. So I feel that we are on the right path. And Nirmala Sitharaman has brought in a very balanced package. And this package may not be, as you said, taking money into the pockets of individuals, but it is going to give a fillip to the country's economy in the times to come. And what was the main point? It was self-reliance. Atmanirbhar Bharat. So Atmanirbhar Bharat does not mean giving out doles to the people. That we have done enough. You all know 30 crore, most of us are Indians, I can talk in crores. 30 million, more than 30 million accounts have been opened in the country. And 300 million accounts, 32 crores. 32 crore people have received 1,000 rupees per pocket for those migrant and those laborers who are off job, who had no assignments. The government of India put it directly to DBT. This is our biggest achievement. Then for the women, see, you know that we have 8 crore Ujjwalas, three months of free cylinders, gas cylinders to every Ujjwala, every household. Over that, 2 months food foodstuffs to every migrant worker, every family, every poor. We have increased and we have, you know, our PDS system so far that we are distributing free food grains to the poor at every level. And we have enhanced labor, as you said. This is direct DBT, as I'm telling you, and direct support. We have increased the, we have also increased the government of India and, through the states, for the disabled, for the old and others, the pensions that they were getting that have also been enhanced and put into their accounts. So all this is when the SHG groups, the self-help groups of women, they've given additional money to start there. And all these masks are being now built, being made by these SHGs. So we are trying to give a fillip to every group, every component of our economy, which is associated with the villages or with you could say the lower level. Because as you said, in our country, most of the people are associated with village life or with hard labor. So this is one aspect. And therefore, as I said, that a lot of it has been done. And this MNREGA, Mahatma Gandhi Rural Employment Scheme, in this scheme, it has been enhanced by 40%. And we all know that more than 3 crore people are going to get jobs through this, the MNREGA. And they're starting enlisting very heavily. The labor has also been increased, the emoluments have been increased. So this is being done. If it is not direct going into pocket, it's monthly provision for how they will get back on their feet. Yet I'm not saying it's enough. But therefore I say that this new package that has come, out of this new package, which is of $265 billion, 20 lakh crores, you will appreciate that most of about 1/3, 30% has gone to the MSPs and to smaller businesses to restart and to come on their own feet. And the market is being opened gradually. As you said, the service sector will take a hard hitting. I was the tourism minister of my state, UP, for 2 years. I know that the tourism sector is going to take a very hard beating, and so with the hospitality sector. But this is absolutely imperative. Nobody can do anything about it. But we have a very strong government. And you know, this is not the end of the packages that are coming. First came 1,65,000 crores to give direct relief of food and security and other, health securities to the people who were locked down. And now we have given this package, the government of India has given this package in the MSMEs, the farming sector, 9 crore, these carts are going to be distributed to the farmers so that they can take easy debts or easy loans. So things are being done, and fisheries and other correlated farming sectors are being promoted in a big way. So we are trying our best, and I'm absolutely in line with Professor Jain, who's just said that India is going to become one of the strongest world economies. Because after China, the biggest trend that India has is its power and cheap labor also for others. There are so many transformations going on. Right now, I feel as a politician, what I am doing is I'm touring on the highways. I'm going to the community kitchens, which are run by the government or run by the NGOs. And the government is putting in thousands and thousands of buses. My state, my chief minister is in terms of giving, because UP, has the UP and Bihar have the maximum migrant workers in different parts of the country. They're all returning. We have taken, UP has taken more than 400 trains. We have booked, we are bringing back our migrant workers. They are being provided with buses. But the problem is, that people have become very anxious, over-anxious, and they're afraid, and they're moving on by foot. They're moving by road. They're walking down. They're taking small transports. This is worrying us, and we are trying to, streamline the systems. We are going to the villages, telling the village people not to shun these people, not just to have empathy for them, sympathy for them, provide for them, give them love, give them consideration. They have suffered so much. So I think at this psychological level, a lot is to be done. whether it's a small family, poor family, or a rich family, I think we are all living in fear, because all those 30,000 Indians were returning from abroad through by the air services that the government of India started. I find their families are also very scared. What happens if he has a coronavirus? He's coming from London, he's coming from US, Middle East, or from wherever. So I feel that right now we have to tackle with this at several levels. Politically, I'm sure that most of the world is on one plank. Everybody wants to fight it. The pharmaceutical firms, the research centers, they're all trying to bring out some antidote for this virus, a vaccine. That will take time. So as Dr. Vivek Gupta said, and as all of you are also certain, that we don't have to fear, but we have to take caution. And precaution comes only through educating the people, not frightening them. And I think my Prime Minister has done a wonderful job by communicating with the people of the country, not once, several times, and trying to create a system in consultation with the state chief ministers, with various political parties, with other stakeholders, every section of the society, whether they are the religious society or the business community, or they are the social sector people, or the bureaucrats. So I think what India is doing is that this was the second step. First step was 165 crores immediate relief. Now this is 20 lakh crores. And now, as Nirmala Sitharaman said, that this is the second step. Now we'll come to the third. So let us hope that we'll all stand by each other. The world will hold hands, and we are a global village now. But this global enterprises, communication is going to be disrupted except through the internet. So I'm very pleased to be with all of you, and I won't take much of your time. I don't know how many hours Professor Vivek Gupta has slated this webinar for, because I think so many intelligent and so many, you know, people from different sectors. So thanks to Professor Gupta, and I'm pleased to be a part of this very educated and a very enlightened group of people who have come together to discuss, debate, and to find ways to how to fight corona and how to strengthen the national and international economies. Thank you.
Thank you very much for a very enlightening words. In fact, you represented the government and you have said rightly what our Prime Minister has done. And without taking much of time, but I will request you to stay on for a little more while, because we have 3-4 more speakers. They will be brief. Mr. Sakate, Khaitan, we will go back to London, which is 4.5 hours behind us. And Mr. Sakate Khaitan will speak, then Mr. Motilal Sethi will speak, and then Mr. Nirmal Jain from Jaipur and Chakresh Jain from Agra. But they're important people, and I would request they will speak because Mr. Sakate has to go a little early, but I have to find him where he... Sakate... Okay, so...
What time are you ending? What is your time slot?
We will finish in within half an hour now. But
all right, I'll stay on. I want to listen to everybody.
So that's because
I want to listen to Akanksha.
Pankaj Jeswani will also sing some songs for the lightning in such a otherwise stressful condition. Mr. Sakate Khaitan, please introduce yourself.
Yeah, thank you, Professor Dr. Gupta, and thank you for inviting me on this. Dr. Kohli and Ms. Bahuguna, it was indeed a pleasure to hear you and the other panelists. I'll just talk very briefly on my views as to the way I see things panning out. Clearly, as everybody knows, that the decision that economies had to make was between the economy and money and people and health. As far as most economies in different percentages go, they chose people and health and locked down. Oxfam has said that 81% of all workers have not been working, as an example. The impact on the economy, therefore, has been extremely deep. And here, when I talk about deep, it is reflected with the number of migrant workers going back to their home states in India, whether it be from the industrial states of Gujarat and Maharashtra, going back to Bihar and Jharkhand, as an example, or West Bengal. Now, that obviously is a plight that all of us have been moved by. And what it does lead to is where is the end result? As Dr. Gupta has said, the vaccine is the only thing that will result in the fear of this virus going away, that it's not going to impact us. Vaccines are 12 to 18 months away. Nothing is going to happen anytime soon, which means the virus is here to stay, and we need to align ourselves and essentially look to do or look to lead our lives and reopen ourselves for business. That impacts the social fabric of the society itself. So what the governments have done is tried to keep the economy in suspended animation through stimulus. As Mr. Bahuguna pointed out, India has got two stimulus packages that have come through. One is of 165 crores and the other is 20 lakh crores. The question will be, is the stimulus enough and will business commence and will there be workers when business commences? So here I have two or three concerns, and the concern is mostly to do with the working capital cycle again starting to move as far as India is concerned. So even if India opens up for business, the question is, can I trust somebody to pay my bill? If I provide a service, will that person pay my bill? Now, if the credit cycle stops and the risk goes up, it will automatically contract the economy, which means on a policy front, there has to be some fiscal stimulus directed through government guarantees at the repayment of bills and invoices for goods and services. Now, this is something that I've talked about in various forums, and I've said that what needs to be provided is a bill discounting, for example, guaranteed by the government so that it does not come back into the bank books. And here, Dr. Kohli is probably much better at commenting on this than me. But from a legal perspective, as long as the amount of outstanding remains the same, which means you have working capital at a steady state, but you are paid for the amount of work or services or goods supplied immediately, the economy will start moving. What that requires is three or four things. The first is, of course, that you have to have a government guarantee or some sort of stimulus for working capital. The second is there has to be policy reform. India needs to go and climb up very, very quickly in regards to its ease of doing business. While the Prime Minister has stated very, very clearly that India is open for business, it wants to attract FDI, it wants to attract business, it wants to attract businesses that are moving from China and looking at alternative destinations, the red tape around business remains. And that really needs to come down. The bureaucracy as well as the government really need to see that even if there is a violation of the law, you don't create the law for the lowest common denominator. Some amount of cheating would need to be accepted, and the cost-benefit analysis of various regulations actually looked into. So to give you an example, with the advent of the insolvency code, essentially three things happened. One, people stopped defaulting in payment of money. Two, enforcement of contracts became easier. And three, the ability to restructure or dissolve businesses became easier. Now, with the suspension of IBC, who's going to make payment of any contract knowing the Indian court system? Which means that for 1 year, everything remains in suspended animation and everything turns into a cash economy, which then means that essentially the economy stops moving. My own belief is that this is a golden opportunity for India. You know, deep reform is possible. Deep reform will lead to animal spirits that India already has been released, and that will lead to India finally taking its place. My belief is India always, always shines when it is put against the wall. It happened in 91, it happened in 2000, it's now happening again today. And therefore, I'm an optimist and I believe in India, and I believe that we will all do very well. Thank you, Dr. Gupta. Back to you.
Thank you very much, Sakate, you have been lovely and speaking from London. You are having lunchtime. I request you to stay on for at least sing last songs at least. So I'll take now Mr. Motilal Sethi ji to introduce himself a little more and speak about. He's the president of All India Leather and he's a garments business, a good friend of ours from India, New Delhi only. Mr. Sethi, please.
Good evening, Dr. Gupta and all panelists here. Indeed, a pleasure. And I must compliment again Dr. Gupta for having a webinar, a unique webinar of this nature, where we are addressing life and livelihood together. In front of life, Dr. Gupta has given a lot of awakening about this COVID, how we have tackled. Compliments to the government of India and the people of India for very well tackling this lockdown period. And the spirit of India has been truly demonstrated by a lot of business houses, organizations, and the people in the business coming forward and voluntarily helping each other in saving and managing this pandemic. I'm very impressed to hear Ms. Bahuguna, Dr. Kohli, Mr. Khaitan, wherein they have all spoken that there is a light at the end of the tunnel. We are all really feeling that surely there is a light at the end of the tunnel. There is a lot of opportunity for India today. There is a lot that we can all do consolidatedly. There is a lot of immense inquiries which are coming towards India. And I think as Indians, we are all having to be gearing up ourselves to really use and utilize this opportunity which this pandemic has brought about, and where the whole world is looking towards an alternate to China, and India is being considered as a viable alternate to China. Here, although speakers have spoken about the reform measures, and I would like to say I'm an exporter selling to more than 5 continents of the world. The perception of India is good today. Overall, this pandemic has taken us back, but it's globally, as Dr. Kohli said, there has going to be a lot of loss of jobs, but the package and the mindset of the government has been demonstrated very well in the last 5 or 6 announcements on these on this financial stimulus being offered to the countrymen and to the industry. While talking about the business, I would say that this is a time for us to be ready. And the Prime Minister has very clearly mentioned in his package speech and addressed the 5 pillars, which are economy, infrastructure, technical driven systems, vibrant demographic and demand. Now, the reason we have been saying that why investments have not been coming to India, and I think in brief, these 5 points which have been addressed by the Honorable Prime Minister, if we all very closely read and understand this, we feel that the Prime Minister is in the mood of having a lot of reforms in this country. And instead of providing cash, which of course as an industry, a lot of people are having to say that the cash has not been given, I personally feel that he has given a fishing rod to work for Indian, and he will be giving the facilitation rod for Indians to work and gear up under these different schemes. And the Make in India will be almost going again another study. Ease of doing business will be again undergoing study, and different schemes of having privatization in various sectors, delicensing, openness, tender system, which I've been hearing Finance Minister last 5 days. I think all have got a lot of meaning attached to every single announcement made by the government in 5 days. And if these are properly and properly seen and understood by the countrymen and by the business community, we can definitely go a long way. Here I've got a few suggestions. That we have been all talking about the opportunity from China, the world, 66% of Americans are wanting to have an alternate supply chain. The world is looking towards India. there is a lot of criticism why Indians are not able to attract foreign investments. But I have some, since Ms. Bhaguna is also with us, I think there is a very immediate need, which through this forum I would like to say and emphasize, that we have got to go very fast now in the government. The reform measures have got to be very fast. There were some reservations that by these all 20 lakh crore has been announced, but how about its implementation? I think the process of implementation need not be slow. It has to go very fast, because I think by the time the world is going to look for the reallocation and things like, we have 6 months of time, where I think entire things have got to be brought into order. And from the government side, you need to be looking as reforming Make in India, ease of doing business, policy measures. And from the business side, we need to be having more discipline. And I think the government is already talking about giving land, cheap land. And I think foreign investors are being addressed from this forum to please come with the open arms, where we are having labor reforms. We've got liquidity. MSME liquidity has been created by 3.7 lakh crores of finance available to MSMEs. And I think the projections are that MSME will be having 50% of the GDP in next 5 years' time. Wherever I think MSME minister has also been coming open and encouraging the small and medium industry. So this is a time for industrialization for India. This is a time for growth for India. And as Mr. Kohli said, for being the economic power of the world. There is nobody who can stop us from being this economic power if we can read between the lines and if we can truly understand the spirit demonstrated by our Honorable Prime Minister Shri Narendra Modi ji. And with this note, I would like to say that the industry and the government and the people of India have to come forward and take this forward. And what about demographic, what is said, 65% of Indians who are young have got a very major responsibility in understanding what is written between the lines and take the economy forward and fulfill the aspirations and dreams of Prime Minister of having a self-reliant India. With these notes, I wish all of you very best. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I think everybody is saying that India is going to become an economical superpower, and they have this will be the, one of the best thing to do. In fact, if you can really snatch all the factories which China has been doing. You see, I'm using the phone Oppo and we are using iPhone, OnePlus, everything is China. So I don't know how they could do it. And in fact, they have done it. They have to be congratulated, but India will need a little more of work. So I will now request Mr. Chakresh Jain and then Mr. very briefly, Mr. Nirmal Jain, both of them are from their friend, to say their words and regarding what their business is affected, how they are deeply affected and how we can really help with them. Chakresh Jain, please go ahead, and then we'll take Mr. Nirmal Jain, and then when we'll have two or three songs, and I request Honorable Minister, Honorable Madam Reeta Bahuguna ji, to stay back. Very interesting, because he's a very good singer, and it will be very nice to hear him, Mr. Jeswani. So, Mr. Jain, please.
Thank you, Dr. Vivek Gupta ji. जैसा कि आप सब लोगों को पता है कि कोरोना वायरस चाइना से निकलकर पूरे वर्ल्ड में फैल गया और संपूर्ण वर्ल्ड की इकोनॉमी पर विपरीत प्रभाव पड़ा. हमारे इंडिया भी इससे अछूता नहीं है. यह वायरस बहुत तेजी से फैला.
Let me introduce him. He has done the Yamuna Expressway. You are the person, your company made the Yamuna Expressway or the Agra Expressway, something?
Agra Lucknow Expressway.
Okay, so he has been, his company is a PNC group or what is this?
PNC.
Okay, very nice. Okay, please go ahead.
परंतु लगातार प्रयासों के बावजूद भी अभी तक हम कोई कारगर वैक्सीन तैयार नहीं हो पाई है. वर्तमान में इस महामारी से बचने का एकमात्र उपाय है लॉकडाउन, जो कि वर्ल्ड के सभी देश लागू कर रहे हैं. इससे कोरोना की रोकथाम में काफी हद तक सफलता भी मिली है. इंडिया में इकोनॉमी के सुधार हेतु गवर्नमेंट ऑफ इंडिया के द्वारा प्रायोरिटी पर अनेक योजनाओं को लागू किया जा रहा है. इंडिया के MSME, SME और सभी प्रकार की इंडस्ट्रीज के लिए अलग अलग इकोनॉमी के पैकेज को गवर्नमेंट के द्वारा लागू किया जा रहा है, जिससे कि इंडिया प्रत्येक क्षेत्र में इक्वलिटी के साथ आर्थिक विकास के रास्ते पर चलकर आत्मनिर्भरता हासिल करने में सफल हो सके. इंडिया की प्रेजेंट इकोनॉमी कंडीशंस लो होने के कारण फाइनेंशियल फेलियर नहीं है, बल्कि एक प्राकृतिक आपदा के कारण गवर्नमेंट ऑफ इंडिया के द्वारा जो भी उपाय किए जा रहे हैं उनसे विश्वास है हम अपनी इकोनॉमी को शीघ्र ही व्यवस्थित कराने में समर्थ होंगे। इंडिया में रेट ऑफ इंटरेस्ट वर्ल्ड के अन्य देशों की तुलना में हमेशा से अधिक रही है, इसी कारण हम उचित समय पर फाइनेंशियल क्राइसिस का मुकाबला करने में भी सफलता प्राप्त करने में अग्रसर होंगे। आरबीआई ने इंडिया में इंडस्ट्रीज के लिए इकोनॉमी को व्यवस्थित करने के लिए रिलीफ पैकेजों का प्राविधान किया है, जिसके कारण इंडिया की इकोनॉमी नॉर्मल होगी, इंडस्ट्रीज की बैलेंस शीटें इंप्रूव होंगी, एक्सपेंसेस पर कंट्रोल से कैश फ्लो भी मेंटेन होंगे। यह कोविड 19 इंडिया के लिए एक नया इंडस्ट्री मॉडल के रूप में आया है। इसके लिए गवर्नमेंट ऑफ इंडिया स्टेट गवर्नमेंट को इंडस्ट्री फ्रेंडली पॉलिसी बनानी चाहिए। आज चाइना में बेजेज इंडिया से ज्यादा हैं। हमारे पास प्रोडक्शन के लिए मैन पावर और कंजम्पशन कैपेसिटी के लिए 130 करोड़ पॉपुलेशन है। ऐसा मेरा मानना है कि कोरोना से पहले चाइना की जो कंडीशन है इंडिया आने वाले 10 सालों में उसे कई गुना बेहतर होगा। धन्यवाद डॉक्टर विवेक गुप्ता, आपकी टीम को भी बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद देता हूँ, उन्होंने इतना अच्छा वेबिनार ऑर्गेनाइज किया। थैंक यू सो मच।
थैंक यू वेरी मच मिस्टर चक्रेश जैन, अ गुड फ्रेंड ऑफ आवर्स फ्रॉम आगरा एंड आल्सो हैविंग ऑफिस इन दिल्ली। आई नाउ रिक्वेस्ट द लास्ट मिस्टर निर्मल जैन, हु इज डूइंग लॉट ऑफ फिलैंथ्रोपी आल्सो। He has been used doing. I have seen video that he has been distributing lot of fruit, lot of food.
Dr. Vivek Gupta, can I ask some questions?
Who is it, please? Mr. Rajnish Gupta.
हाँ जी, हाँ जी.
Rajnish ji, बस इनका इनका थोड़ा सा वक्त तब सुन ले Mr. Nirmal Jain साहब का जयपुर से.
उसके बाद कुछ suggestion भी देना चाहूँगा मैं.
Okay, good. Mr. Nirmal Jain, please go ahead.
सबसे पहले तो आपको बहुत-बहुत हार्दिक धन्यवाद कि आपने मुझे आप जैसे लोगों में शामिल किया और आप मेरे से परिचित हैं ही, और आपने रीता बहुगुणा जी को भी बुलाया, उन्होंने सबका मार्गदर्शन किया, आपके सारे इकोनॉमिस्ट को सुना। सबसे बड़ी बात यह है कि इस समय जो ये कोविड 19 चल रहा है तो आप जैसे बुद्धिजीव, अपन जैसे ग्रुप के लोग इस भारत को इस स्थिति से निकाल के ला सकते हैं, क्योंकि अपन लोग चिंतन करने की स्थिति में है, बाकी लोग चिंतन करने की स्थिति में नहीं है। और आपने राजनेताओं को भी जोड़ा है तो निश्चित रूप से ये बात वहां तक पहुंचेगी। और आपको तो सब जानते ही हैं, पूरे देश में सारे राजनेता अमित शाह जी जानते हैं आपको, मोदी जी आपको जानते हैं, आप वेल नोन फिगर हैं आज की तारीख में। तो मैं चाहूँगा कि ये बात वहाँ तक पहुँचेगी और आप सबकी बात वहाँ तक पहुँचाने में डॉक्टर गुप्ता जी बहुत योगदान पहुँचाएंगे। थैंक यू डॉक्टर गुप्ता जी, बहुत बहुत आपका हार्दिक धन्यवाद और हार्दिक आभार कि आपने इस सब में शामिल किया, और मैं आपके लिए सदैव तत्पर हूँ, एवरी टाइम एवरी वेयर। थैंक यू डॉक्टर गुप्ता जी।
Thank you for your friendship and you have been very kind, and I have seen the videos where you have distributed lot of food through your Jain society. He's a big businessman, he has not introduced himself, and he's a very down to earth person and friend of many ministers himself. So I will now request Madam Reeta ji to stay on, but one question we are taking from Mr. Rajnish Gupta, he wants to ask some question, and then we'll go to our Pankaj Jeswani ji. Where is Rajnish, where are you? I cannot see you. Yes, I can see. Please introduce yourself quickly. Yes. सॉरी, आप अनम्यूट करिए अपने को। वी कैन नॉट हियर यू।
आ रही आवाज?
बोलिए।
आ रही है सर। मेरा एक क्वेश्चन है सर कि इतना लॉकडाउन 4 भी चल रहा है, सब कुछ प्रयास हो रहे हैं, पर फिर भी हमारी संख्या लाखों में पहुंच रही है कोरोना की। लोग एसिम्प्टोमेटिक कोरोना के होते जा रहे हैं, लोगों में फियर बढ़ता जा रहा है, क्या इस चीज के लिए हमें और क्या प्रयास हमारी सरकार को और हमें मिलकर करने चाहिए जो हम इस कोरोना वायरस की महामारी को और तेजी से कंट्रोल कर सके और बचाव कर सके?
मैडम, वुड यू लाइक टू आंसर दिस टू हिम? आप अनम्यूट करिए अपने को। सॉरी,
ही इज आस्किंग यू, दिस इज अ
This is a question for a
anybody. Anybody can give an answer to me.
I will answer. Of course, you see.
You have to answer why it's happening. Yeah.
You see, I told you that this virus is dangerous in two ways. दो वजह से परेशान कर रहा है, because ये highly infective है. पहले ऐसा होता था कि आप खांसी जुकाम बुखार के पास patient आता था, भाई दूर रहो थोड़ा सा, हमको बुखार ना, हमको जुकाम ना हो जाए. लेकिन इसमें तो 99% will infect the people. Secondly, ये airborne भी है. When it is airborne, तो ये आप 1 meter, 2 meter. I will again tell you that शुरू में it was only 1 meter, then I said 2 meter, then it was 2 गज. प्रधानमंत्री जी ने कहा 2 गज की दूरी. दूसरी बात यह है कि dangerous है इसके लिए. Lockdown, आपको सोशल नॉर्म चेंज करना पड़ेगा. आई फील दैट वी हैव टू लिव विद दिस वायरस टिल द वैक्सीन इज देयर. हो सकता है कुछ जादुई दवा आ जाए, हमारे फादर ने भी प्रपोज किया हुआ है, जो कि दवा आ गई, कुछ दवा आ गई, मेडिसिन आ गई जो कि वायरस को किल कर सकती है, जैसे इवरमेक्टिन के बारे में मैंने बताया, इसका ह्यूमन ट्रायल हो जाए. अगर ह्यूमन ट्रायल नहीं भी होता है, सेफ मेडिसिन कैन बी यूज इट, बट इंडियन मेडिकल दिस इज सच ए ग्लोबल इशू, यू कैन नॉट गिव एम्पिरिकल मेडिसिन अनलेस दिस इज रियली क्लियर बाय एथिकल कमिटी और इंडियन काउंसिल ऑफ मेडिकल रिसर्च. तो अभी इसके बारे में करना यही है कि मास्क हमेशा पहनिए. मैं तो कमरे में उतारा है, अभी भी उतारा है मैंने. आप जैसे मैंने बताया कि नाउ द फियर एंड पैनिक इज ग्रोइंग, इज नॉट गोइंग डाउन, तो वी हैव टू वेयर द मास्क. जो बाहर से लोग आ रहे हैं आपके यहाँ, घर में काम करने वाले, उनको उतारने को मत कहिए. कुछ लोग नीचे मास्क पहन लेते हैं, ऐसे यो पहन लेते हैं, दिस इज नॉट गुड. यू हैव टू रियली कवर द नोज एंड यू हैव टू बी वेरी केयरफुल टू चेंज द मास्क एटलीस्ट एवरी डे, एक दिन में. N95 can be re-sterilized, कुछ लोग क्लॉथ पहन रहे हैं. तो महामारी से बचने का तरीका यही है कि we have to take care, but don't panic. कुछ ना कुछ आएगा, हमको लगता है कुछ repurpose medicine जल्दी आएंगी जिसका हम इस्तेमाल कर पाएंगे. Thank you very much, Mr.
एक शेयर अनुभव करना चाहता हूँ सर. सर मैं,
हाँ बताइए बताइए क्विकली
सर. मैं, मेरी आवाज सुन पा रहे हैं सर?
Yes, yes, I can, we can hear you. बताइए.
मैं सुन पा रहे हैं, मैं अनुभव सुन रहा हूँ. मेरे साले को पिछले 2 हफ्ते पहले कोरोना वायरस हो गया, और उनका नाम वीरेंद्र बंसल है, मॉडल टाउन में रहते थे. उनको हमने आयुर्वेदिक काढ़ा, आयुर्वेदिक हर्ब्स दी और उनको क्वारंटाइन किया, सारी प्रिकॉशन मेजर की और सारा जो क्वारंटाइन की जो कंडीशन था सारी लागू की घर पे ही, और घर पे ही उनका 14 दिन के अंदर ठीक कर दिया. और उनका टीवी रेडियो में सब जगह इंटरव्यू आया, पूरी फैमिली को हो गया धीरे धीरे. लेकिन मैंने देखा है कि अगर जो हम प्रॉपर मॉनिटरिंग करते हैं, प्रॉपर कंडीशंस को ओबे करते हैं और प्रॉपर हम उसके लिए इम्यूनिटी बूस्टर लेते हैं, तो हम इस कोरोना वायरस से जल्दी से रिकवर कर सकते हैं.
इम्यूनिटी इज वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट. अगर बॉडी की इम्यूनिटी बढ़ाई जाए,
हमने उनकी इम्यूनिटी को इम्प्रूव किया आयुर्वेदिक हर्ब्स के जरिए और कुछ होम्योपैथिक ड्रग्स के जरिए, और क्वारंटाइन के पूरी प्रोटेक्शन करके और सैनिटाइजेशन करके प्रॉपर बॉइल्ड वाटर दिया, हॉट वाटर और स्टीमिंग और ऑल द थिंग्स वी हैव डन टू देम, और उनको 10 दिन के अंदर ही रिकवरी आ गई.
देखिए
पूरी फैमिली रिकवर हो गई.
ठीक है ठीक है. ओके, लेट मी टेल यू द गवर्नमेंट गाइडलाइन इज इफ यू आर इन्फेक्टेड यू हैव टू बी हॉस्पिटलाइज्ड. अभी घर में, अभी गाइडलाइन ऐसी नहीं आई है कि आप घर में ट्रीट करें, घर में इलाज नहीं हो सकता है. ये क्वेश्चन कल भी पूछा था मैं एक वेबिनार में. होता क्या है कि इफ यू आर रियली गुड इनफ यू कैन क्वारंटाइन योरसेल्फ, लेकिन व्हेन यू आर एट होम इट इज वेरी डिफिकल्ट फॉर दैट पर्सन टू स्टे, दूसरे रूम में आ ही जाएगा. तो हॉस्पिटलाइजेशन इज इंपॉर्टेंट. इंक्रीजिंग इम्यूनिटी, आई एग्री विद यू, इम्यूनिटी बढ़ानी पड़ेगी. उसके लिए बेस्ट इज विटामिन सी एंड कोक्यू एंजाइम. देखिए बात है, आयुर्वेदिक
विटामिन सी भी दिया, विटामिन डी भी दिया, जिंक भी दिया उनको हमने.
लेट मी कंप्लीट.
हाँ जी, ओके सर.
अच्छा किया है, लेट मी कंप्लीट. मैं कह रहा था कि अगर इम्यूनिटी बढ़ाने की, फॉर द पीपल इट इज बीइंग वॉच्ड बाय मोर देन 10,000 पीपल ऑल ओवर द वर्ल्ड, इज गोइंग फेसबुक लाइव, वेरियस सेशंस आर गोइंग ऑन, इज बीइंग रिकॉर्डेड बाय Zoom, इट विल बी अगेन रिपीट टेलीकास्ट. फॉर द इंटरेस्ट ऑफ द पीपल आई वुड लाइक टेल यू, इम्यूनिटी बढ़ाने का बेस्ट तरीका है विटामिन सी, ऑरेंजेस, संतरा, ये सब चीजें. दूसरी बात है, कोक्यू एंजाइम नाम की दवा आती है जो कि सेल पे काम करती है. इसका कोई प्रूवन रोल नहीं है, लेकिन इट्स वेरी इजीली अवेलेबल, वन शुड टेक इट टू इंक्रीज द इम्यूनिटी. थर्डली एक्सरसाइज.
डॉक्टर साहब, आई थिंक शुड बी एंडिंग प्लीज. आई थिंक लेट अस कंक्लूड प्लीज.
ओके, सो नाउ वी हैव टू कंक्लूड दिस थिंग. नाउ वी हैव टू गो टू मिस्टर पंकज जेसवानी. वी हैव टू रियली लिसन टू हिम, ही हैज बीन वेटिंग फॉर अ लॉन्ग टाइम. मैडम, कैन यू स्टे फॉर अदर 5-7 मिनट्स, बिकॉज़ ही इज अ वेरी गुड सिंगर. ही विल एंथ्रल अस नाउ. So everything is now summarized. It will go there. Let me talk to where is Mr. Jeswani gone? Jeswani sahab, I cannot see him. Yes, he's there. Okay. Namaste.
Can you hear me, sir?
नमस्ते नमस्ते
नमस्कार नमस्कार
नमस्कार
आवाज आ रही है सबको डॉक्टर विवेक गुप्ता जी का धन्यवाद करूंगा सबसे पहले बहुत सुंदर वी आर डूइंग अ वेरी ग्रेट जॉब फॉर ह्यूमैनिटी मैनकाइंड सबको अवेयर कर रहे हैं सबके व्यूज और एक्सपीरियंसेस शेयर करवा रहे हैं आप सब लिसन टू मी
यस यस क्लियर एंड लाउड प्लीज गो अहेड
अभी जो सबने कहा मैं एक गीत के माध्यम से दो लाइनों के माध्यम से कंक्लूड करना चाहूंगा आपके टॉपिक को आपके क्योंकि अकेला कोई नहीं कर पाएगा पीएम साहब भी कोशिश कर रहे हैं सीएम साहब भी कर रहे हैं सभी मंत्री और सभी डॉक्टर सभी पूरा मीडिया और पूरा पुलिसकर्मी सभी इसी मुहिम में है लेकिन अकेला कोई कुछ नहीं कर पाएगा करना खुद भी कर पड़ेगा सबको मिलके उसके लिए दो लाइनें गीत की बड़ी सुंदर है आप सुनिए हाथी हाथ बढ़ाना हाथी हाथ बढ़ाना एक अकेला हट जाएगा मिलकर बोझ उठाना हाथी हाथ बढ़ाना हाथी हाथ बढ़ाना साथी रे हाथी हाथ बढ़ाना साथी रे सबको मिलकर करना पड़ेगा अभी मैंने एक चीज सीखी इतने मैसेजेस से जस्ट रिमेम्बर SMS SMS कहते हैं ना सर मैसेज SMS सैनिटाइजेशन मास्क एंड सोशल डिस्टेंसिंग SMS याद रखिए डिस्टेंस रखना पड़ेगा लोगों को खुद समझ आनी चाहिए हम तो हैमरिंग कर रहे हैं लोगों को कि डिस्टेंस रखो सैनिटाइज करो खुद समझ आना चाहिए ठीक है सर तो मैं इस टॉपिक से हट के कुछ संगीत की बात कर रहा हूँ एक गीत डॉक्टर विवेक गुप्ता जी के लिए बहुत ही सुंदर है मैं मैडम का भी धन्यवाद कर रहा हूँ कि मैं दे रही है थोड़ा सा रियली ऑनर्ड एंड ग्रेटफुल ये सुंदर सा नगमा आपकी पसंद का भी होगा जो तुमको हो पसंद वो भी बात कहेंगे ठीक है सर डॉक्टर गुप्ता जी स्वागत कीजिए थैंक यू जो तुमको वो पसंद वो भी बात कहेंगे जो तुमको वो पसंद वो भी बात कहेंगे तुम दिन को अगर रात का हो रात कहेंगे जो तुमको वो पसंद वो भी बात कहेंगे देते ना आप साथ तो मर जाते हम कभी के देते ना आप साथ तो मर जाते कभी के पूरे हुए आप से अरमान जिंदगी के जिंदगी को आप की हम आपकी आवाज करेंगे तुम दिन को अगर कहेंगे जो तुमको वो पसंद वो भी बात करेंगे
एक किशोर कुमार जी का सुना दीजिए बस वन मोर एक किशोर कुमार जी का सुना दीजिए बस इसके बाद फिनिश ऑफ
ठीक है सर मैं एक ऐसा करता हूँ हल्का सा मेडले पेश कर देता हूँ आपके लिए पांच छह गानों का समावेश हर तरह के गीत सुना जाएंगे
हाँ ठीक है दर्शन
एक गाना बहुत लंबा हो जाता है उसमें डिफरेंट डिफरेंट आपको सॉन्ग्स मिलेंगे यू विल एंजॉय ऑल सिंगर्स
बिल्कुल बिल्कुल
चार मिनट दीजिएगा बहुत बढ़िया
Thank you. Thank you.
I think this is the best song to close the session. Kabhi alvida na kehna. Bahut acha ki aapne Pankaj Jeswani.
Thank you, sir. I'm honored. Main bahut bahut dhanyawad karta hu. Aap mujhe yaad karte hain. Itne esteemed logon mein, itni elite gathering mein, aap mujhe bhi samman dete hain. Aur thoda mere jariye manager ho jata hai. Bahut bahut dhanyawad aapka.
Yeah, before I end this, I just want to introduce my friend, Mr. Dr. Ashokan, who was doing an emergency work. He's a pillar of IECR and we have done a lot of such webinars together. He's working in Fatima Hospital in Calicut in Kerala. And he's one of the important ones. Just say hello to everybody, then we'll take your comments later on.
Good evening. Sorry, I was held up in the hospital. I could not join you on time. Anyway, I think you had a great session and it's excellent. Song, Pangaji, and I think it's you almost finished the discussion. I think
yes, yes. So this was actually what you missed most was the Honorable Minister. She was there, and she's just I think left. And what you missed was economy. So I finally thank everybody to be there on this webinar, and this is the conclusion of this webinar. And anybody else want to say something and then we close? Mr. Sharad Kohli, you can close, do the closing word, and Mr. Zarir can do the closing word. One last comment, yes. Anything else you want to say? Mr. Sharad Kohli, would you like to say something finally just to conclude?
Yeah. Just unmute. Yes. Well, I think everything has been said. I'll just say it in one line. I mean, it was such an engrossing seminar. वेबिनार एंड आई थिंक पंकज जेसवानी की मुकाबला तो नहीं कर सकता पर सिर्फ एक लाइन में जरूर कहूंगा आज जाने की जिद ना करो आज जाने की जिद ना करो यूं ही पहलू में बैठे रहो यूं ही सोम बैठे रहो आज जाने की जिद ना करो थैंक यू सो मच डॉक्टर गुप्ता थैंक यू सो मच एवरीवन एल्स दैट्स वेरी स्वीट ऑफ यू थैंक यू
आई थिंक यू कैन बी इकोनॉमिस्ट एंड सिंगर बोथ नेक्स्ट टाइम
नो
ओके सो आवर नेक्स्ट वेबिनार शुक्र वी विल बी ऑन मोस्ट प्रोबब्ली विल कंबाइन द हार्ट बिकॉज़ वन स्पीकर फ्रॉम लंदन डॉक्टर कार्लो मारियो विल स्पीक And he's now shifted to Italy. And then we will have Mr. Anil Sabharwal, who is the CEO of Adani Power. I requested Mr. Rajesh Adani to come in because he's the brother of Kodam and both are closely known to me. But Mr. Rajesh Adani has said Anil Sabharwal will come. Most probably we'll do this on coming Thursday instead of Wednesday. So it will be a combination of the economy plus a little of heart from America and from Italy. So we'll discuss this again on Thursday evening. Wednesday will become too close for me to arrange. And I thank you with all Sharad Kohli, Mr. Jeswani, Mr. Motilal, Sethi, Chakresh Jain, Mr. Nirmal Jain, Akansha Ji, Alok Kumar Ji, Ajnish Jain Ji, whatever I can. Of course, the madam was there. Our Honorable Madam was Reeta Bahuguna Ji, who is a close family friend for almost 2 hours. She stayed with us. She had to go for a meeting. That's why she said Namaste and then she left away. Thank you very much. This was a Facebook Live on various platforms, as I told you, and recorded by Zoom, and this will go on to YouTube. Thank you, Sharad Ji. Bahut acha aapne bola aur sare kafi economy ke bare mein bataya jo hum log pata nahi hai. And thanks to Ashokan for coming in the last moment, Chakresh Ji, and we'll talk on phone later on. Thank you. I'm going to close this meeting. If I have left anybody's name, I'm sorry, but I think the things were very nice. And Mr. I think aap thoda riyaz aur kare agar to aapko hi singing mein hi aapko le liya karenge. Sing very well. Thank you. I'm finishing the meeting now for everybody and namaste, finally namaste and of course namaste has become a thing of for everybody all over the world. Thank you Ashok, thank you very much.
Bye.